In this video, I'll teach you all you need to know to deploy your app to a Kubernetes cluster. Hi, it's Stefan from Deep Data Ocean, where we help you getting rid of your software monolith or your legacy software application. When you're new here, make sure to click the subscribe button, and all the links and everything I mentioned in the video are linked below in the comments. And if you like the video, please give me a thumbs up, that does make a difference. As an experienced software developer, you really know what you need to do to develop your app. But do you also know what you need to do to deploy it to a Kubernetes cluster? You need to know two things. Kubernetes objects, like deployment, service or ingress. And you need to know how to talk to the Kubernetes API so that you can deploy all the things you need to deploy. Once you've deployed your first app for the first time, you might experience that it's not coming up correctly. So normally, there are some issues with the database, so it cannot connect to the database and it's crashing. So it's crash looping. You can look into the log files, but afterwards you might need to debug a bit more. So at the end of the video, I'll show you a trick how to create a debug pod on Kubernetes that you can use to further investigate why it's not coming up. So make sure to stick till the end of the video to see that. Let us start having a look to the architecture of Kubernetes. So we are basically having a couple of nodes that are masters, as well as a couple of other nodes which are workers. So let's say we are having here maybe two nodes, and for the workers we're having a couple of nodes depending on the size of your cluster. So the masters are mainly for providing an API. So the masters don't know more than just talk to the outside world and to the workers. So when you're saying I'm having a nice container image that I want to run on maybe two workers, then you're telling the master, please make this happen. So for this, you need to tell the master what he shall do. And you're doing this by explaining Kubernetes objects to the API, which is firstly the deployment. So in the deployment, you're telling the master how to start a container. So you could say, please take this specific image and run it on two workers somewhere. And you don't even know where it's working. You just tell the master what to do and he will do it behind the scenes. And you do this by applying a YAML file. So you are telling the masters how this deployment works by using a deployment YAML. So you're basically saying, please take this image, run it on the workers, and apply a couple of environment variables, so to configure the container, basically. Once you have done that, you might want to create a service. So again, another YAML file that describes a service. So in the service, you can tell Kubernetes to do some load balancing. You can say, I'm having these two guys here, these two containers running on two workers. So dear masters, please provide a load balancer that balances the load between these workers by applying a service YAML. Well, and there are some others like an ingress. So with an ingress, you can explain Kubernetes that you want to access the load balancer from the outside world and just apply an ingress. And there are others like config map or secrets that are not part of this video, but if you would love to learn about them, please leave a comment below. I'm happy to do this in another video. So the question is, how can we talk with the API? There are a couple of possible ways. In this video, which is just a crash course, we are using the tool kubectl. And for the kubectl, we can say, please take this YAML file, dear API, and do whatever it's described there. There are also other things like Helm. If you're interested in also learning about Helm, again, please leave me a message below in the comments. And by the way, if you want to learn a little bit about how to create an EKS cluster, a Kubernetes cluster on Amazon, there is another video where I'm explaining exactly that, and also another video about Docker, so how to create or how to create a Docker image that contains your app. There's another video that I will be probably there, or that you will see here on the video. So let's go now to the computer and let's have a look into the YAML files and how to use the kubectl for that. So let us now have a look into the YAML files. The first one here is the deployment YAML, where we describe how we want to see the container running on the Kubernetes cluster. So the important line here is kind, that tells Kubernetes that we're talking about a deployment. And then we're having user, name user. So basically what I've done here, I've used a user service, so a microservice that talks about the object user. And that's what we want to start on the Kubernetes cluster. So later on, when we are starting a service, we want the service to take this, or the containers being deployed by this deployment. And that's why we have to set the labels to app.colon user. So this is later on picked up by the service YAML. Here we're saying we want to have one replica up and running. We could also say, please give us three replicas. So whenever one is crashing, there are still up and running, but for our example, one is good enough. So then we are saying, when you want to create the container, please take this image here with this image path and pull always the new image and just get it started here. So let me try to use the kubectl command. Kubectl apply -f for file deployment YAML. So now we're deploying the YAML file to the Kubernetes API, which should only take a second, and then we can check what we've got by kubectl get pods. Then we're saying image pull back off. So something went wrong. What was that? So whenever you have an image pull back off, then it means it cannot reach the image. That can have different solutions. So maybe the image is wrong, like in this scenario. So I just put in an image name with a tag wrong, which is obviously wrong. So the correct one is latest. But it could also be that the user doing this is not allowed to access the registry. So these are the things that are quite normal issues that you have to fix then. So now we want to reapply this deployment YAML, just doing it again. And we're checking now. So the beauty of Kubernetes is Kubernetes just deletes the old one and gets us the new one. So let me check what's going on here. So the old one is still terminating and the new one is already running and since 12 seconds. Now we are seeing something bad. It told us this guy here has restarted. So during the startup of the microservice, something happened, so it crashed. And since we're having a nice Kubernetes cluster, it will be started again. But this is bad. This is something we have to fix. So we can do this by checking the log file, kubefile logs-f for please update everything what we're seeing here. Here is the name, copying the name, and now we are seeing what's happening here. Obviously, we got an issue. So let me scroll up. Hickory pull, so this is something to do with the database. Communication link failure, so this is normally the next failure that you have. You're starting the microservice and it cannot reach the database. How can that be? Let us have a look to the database configuration. So this guy has just the container, but nothing like environments variables configured yet. When you're looking to the application properties, we are saying, oh, this guy has a MySQL database locally. So this is normally what you'll see when the developer uses a local database to develop the microservice, with some nice user and password. So what we basically need to do is just pull putting in the same to the environment variables for this container. Let me add an env section here. So here I'm creating the first, oh, that was wrong. Let me copy this guy just to give you the trick. So this is a YAML notation. We would rather have this as a environment variable notation, which is nothing more than uppercase and all dots are replaced by underscores. This basically does the trick. So let me put in the link of a database that I created for this. There we go. So we also need the user and the password. Push this to the right hand side. Let me see what's going on here. So that was the first one. The next one would be Spring data source username. And we also need the password. So let us try this again. I'm applying again the deployment and let's see what we've got now. So that looks good. It's running now, but again, we got a failure. Let me check the log again. The driver has not received any packets from the server. So this basically means at the given address, it cannot find something. Well, obviously this was wrongly done here. So let me fix this by adding database instead of localhost. And let us try this again. I'm applying the deployment. So, let us check what's happening. Yeah. Spring data source URL, spring data source username, and spring data source password. Here is the issue. So I wrongly spelled the password parameter. Then we got the new name. There we go. Finally, Finally, the application started successfully. So with this, I just showed you the normal way of issues you're running into when you're starting getting your microservice up and running on the Kubernetes cluster. So for this, we have had a look into the deployment YAML and just applied it using kubectl. Let me now also show you the service. So here we're having a kind service. So this is really kind of load balancing between different instances, different replicas. So we are saying here, please select all pods from the Kubernetes cluster that have the app user as a metadata, and that is accessed on the port 80. So when accessing it on the port 80, it will internally forward to the target port 8080. And we can also just, well, apply a service YAML. Then we can get it by kubectl get svc, and we're seeing here a cluster AP. So within the So this one can be accessed from within the cluster using this cluster IP. If you want to get through it coming from external, we have to configure an external IP, which is not part of this tutorial. So that's all for the moment. Basically, you've learned how to create a deployment and apply it to the API. In the beginning, I've promised you a bonus. So basically, the next thing you might want to know is, when you set up the microservice, when you see it came up correctly, but you still cannot reach it, then something else might be difficult. So you might need some further investigations. In the old world of VMware or EC2, you would have just SSH'd into the instance and then just did some debugging using Telnet, using curl. We can basically do something very similar on Kubernetes with this command, with the kubectl run command, with the -it, which means interactive, with the name debug, we can start a CentOS 7 pod on the Kubernetes, which basically means there will be something running on the Kubernetes and you will get a console to it, which is like SSH. So we could, for example, just try to access the API of our service. We can just curl it. So we are on port 80, which we don't need since we have HTTP, and we have an endpoint for getting all users. As we do not have created any users yet, I'm expecting to get an empty result back. And there we go, we got bracket open and close bracket, which basically means there are no users yet. So we have successfully proven that the endpoint itself is working properly fine, and that the issue should be somewhere between Kubernetes and your notebook if you cannot reach it yet. So the next thing you might want to check is whether you can reach some outside world endpoints. Maybe we just want to telnet. Unfortunately, we don't have a telnet in the CentOS 7 image, so we can install it using yum install -y telnet. There we go. So let me just try to telnet to Google on port 443. So we can reach the Google on 443, which basically means that we have internet access from within the Kubernetes cluster. So with this, you can also try to investigate further issues doing NS lookup, whatever you need to do to figure out where the issue actually lies. If you like this video, make sure to give me a thumb up. That does make a difference. And subscribe to the channel so that you get informed when I'm releasing the next video.